Hello everyone, this video will be a tutorial on how to use ABS-Fractal-Explorer 1.0.1. So, to move around, you can use WASD or the arrow keys. If you want to zoom into a fractal, you can press E to zoom in and Q to zoom out. Let's say you're zoomed in pretty far somewhere, you can press R to reset back to the origin. And if you want to change the detail of the fractal, you can use G to decrease the amount of iterations, which will make it faster, but you won't be able to see as far. Or you could use T to increase the iterations, which will give you more detail, but it will also run a bit slower. Iterations will go up to 65,000. If you want to change the fractal, you can press Z, and then you can type in the formula idea you want. So if you want the burning ship fractal, type in 100 and then press enter. If you want the Davis bar fractal, you can type in 16 and then you can get that. Let's say if you make a mistake somewhere, you can press backspace so you can type in the correct number. If you want to change the type of fractal you're on, you can change from quadratic to cubic by doing X, then pressing 3. If you want quartix, you just have to press 4. Then quintix, you just have to press 5. The quintix, they have a lot of formulas that you can explore, so you can go up to formula number 1,048,575. While the quadratic fractals have the least amount of formulas, so you can only explore up to 255. Other features of the program include Julia sets, so if you press C, you can explore a fractal's Julia set by pressing I, J, K, and L, which will move a white dot around. So yeah, this will be the Julia set for the Mandelbrot set. And then this would be the Julia set for the burning ship fractal. Oh yeah, and then using I, J, K, and L will also change the starting Z value, which kind of have this effect on the fractal. If you don't want this effect to happen on the Mandelbrot set, you can press V to disable it, which won't affect the Julia set, and then you could just press V again to re-enable the behavior. So, let's go for a little bit of a zooming into the fractal. So let's load up number 20. And then you may notice something as you start to zoom in. You may notice that the kind of screen kind of looks a bit striped or pixelated, and that's because we ran out of precision. Because since we're rendering on the GPU, we only have precision until about 10 to the 5 zoom in. So in order to fix this, we can just press N so we can render it on the CPU. Now the CPU will be a lot slower, but we will be able to zoom in about twice as far to 10 to the 11 or so. If you want to switch back to GPU rendering, you can press the letter M. And if you only want to use half of your CPU's threads, you can press B, which will make it slower, but it'll give your CPU threads a break from rendering, since it's only using half. It's not recommended to do it like that, though. Just either use full threads or the GPU to render. So, now that we're rendering on the CPU, let's see how much farther we can zoom in. Here's what GPU rendering looks like, so yeah, not much precision. Your GPU has around like thousands of cores, or sometimes hundreds, and that's why it's a lot faster than the CPU, which it can only have up to 16 threads typically on a good gaming computer. As we zoom in, it's getting a little bit harder to render as we have to bump the duration count up quite high. All the pixels on the screen require at least 2,000 iterations. So yeah, we're clicking out a good fair bit. Well, I guess we actually did zoom in a little bit farther than 10 to the 11. Yeah, you might be able to start to see some weird banding effects now. That's due to arithmetic round-off error, since we're running out of digits. Now if we turn up the iterations a little bit more, we can see that, yeah, we ran out of precision. Now if we render this on the GPU, well, we only have precision along the y-axis, so that's why we're still seeing bands. But yeah, if we rendered this like around here on the fractal or there, then it would just be a bunch of large blocks because we lost precision on both sides. Yeah. The cursor has a interesting feature where right here will tell you what the cursor is pointing at. So right here is around -2, 0. Here should be 0.5 real, 1.12 imaginary, and yeah, the frame rate and millisecond rendering here. Right now it's just running at 300 frames per second because that's how long it takes to run through the keyboard scanning. But as soon as we start to move, it starts to drop down a bit. We have our real imaginary coordinates here, our zoom here, and then our iteration count, along with the type of fractal we're on and its ID number. An additional thing the program comes with is a conversion table, so you can input the quadratic formula ID of the fractals from the 75 Mandelbrot variance video I made. So if you want to look at the anchor fractal, which is number 47 in the video, you can go to the conversion table and find that its ID number is 142. Now the interesting thing about the anchor fractal, if we zoom in, we get the double sector fractal, and if we continue to zoom in, we get the pointed Celtic fractal. And if you continue to zoom in just a little bit more, we get the white Celtic fractal, which has an ID number of 136. Yeah. Another interesting property about the quadratic fractals is that a lot of them seem to have these weird cube shapes that come up, which can be seen on the Julia set here. And yeah, something that recurs in a lot of fractals. Not quite sure why, but yeah. Anyways, the final feature of this program that you can do is you can take pictures by pressing P. And then if you want to reset the imaginary and real Julia coordinate, you can press U to reset the real coordinate and I to reset the imaginary coordinate. Anyways, thanks for watching.